Welcome to Start Art with Paul. You join me in lockdown in our studio here in the Highlands of Scotland, from where we bring you this first Paint-a-POSTCARD, Share a Message painting tutorial. Do you want to stay in touch with family and friends? Do you want to reach out across the generations? Why not start painting together and share your experience, even though you may be apart? This is what Paint-a-POSTCARD, Share a Message is all about. So please join in, and I will guide you through the early steps of learning how to draw and paint this beautiful daffodil, a flower that symbolises the joy of springtime. Once you have got used to the framework of the daffodil head on which all the detail is going to be added, and you might try this out on a couple of spare pieces of paper, you'll now be ready to transfer that or draw it up onto your postcard. Before we do so, we need to think of a couple of things. And so I've drawn out four little rectangles here, which sort of represent the postcard that you're going to draw your daffodil out on. Now, on the first one, and I'm going to do this very scribbly and fast so you get the idea, the natural thing is to just start somewhere. And imagine if I did that, and I start up here, and I start my daffodil. I'm going to draw it very quickly so you get the idea. And I draw it in, and suddenly I find that it's positioned in the wrong place. There's a lot of space down here which I haven't used. The space around a drawing is actually as important as the drawing itself. So no matter how well you do the drawing or the painting up in that top left-hand corner, it's always going to look a little odd. Let's look at another thing that you might do. You might start off your daffodil head a little bit lower and suddenly find that it's a little bit too large. And in fact, some of these leaves are going to actually go off the page altogether. So again, you need somehow, as we did right at the beginning, to think of the whole thing before you start to think of detail. So we'll have to think about that when we come to the postcard itself. One more thing that's worth thinking about is this. Supposing instead of thinking of this as a daffodil, think about this as a map. This is a map of a desert island in the middle of an ocean. There's the island, and all of this around it is blue sea. Let's draw another desert island. This is a desert island which you're going to visit and explore. Which of those shapes is more exciting to visit? The one with all the bays and inlets is going to be much more exciting to explore. And it's exactly the same thing with visual things. So if your subject doesn't have any interesting bays and inlets, ways to get inside it, as this one does, this one has all of these shapes that the eye can move around and move into, that shape is much more exciting and worth visiting for the eye. So we're going to think about both these elements when we actually start to work on the postcard itself. Here is my postcard, and my postcard is a little bit larger than a postcard, but it's the same proportion. It's a little bit larger so that the camera can pick up the details a little bit more easily. And there's nothing wrong with you doing it to exactly the same size as I'm doing. So, we now want to transfer all of these thoughts that we've been having about the daffodil onto this surface. And we want to make sure that first of all, it's positioned nicely. We're using as much of this space as possible. And that also, there are lots of bays and inlets in around the outside of this to excite our eye. Well, I like to think of it like this. Supposing a spider were to come along and start creating web on this surface. The web would be very, very fine. We'd hardly be able to see it. And in your drawing, that's what I'd expect the line to be. Very, very gentle. So only you can see it when you're really close to it. I'm going to make my line a little bit stronger so that the camera can pick it up. I'm not going to look at all the detail again. I'm not going to start with my framework. I'm just going to start with a loose shape for the head. And I'm sort of starting with an oval there. And then I'm thinking of the stem coming down. I'll make that a little bit stronger so that you can see it. You can see it's not just one line, it's several. And the stem coming out. Now this is going to be so gentle that it's not going to fix you in any way to put that exactly where it is now. If I suddenly find that it's in the wrong place, you know, it's too much towards that top corner, or it's too close to the bottom, I can easily erase that and draw it somewhere else. These are just you're exploring the surface just as you're exploring the island. You're finding out where that flower head can fall and what it looks like when we start to put in some of the leaves. We know that shape, I've just put it as a lozenge shape, not tremendously exciting in terms of bays and inlets, but you know from doing the structure before that it has a very interesting shape. At the moment, all I'm doing is finding out where I might put the flower head and where I might put the leaves. As I say, if I don't like that, I can move it about. And because that's only taken me a couple of moments to put on the surface, I won't mind rubbing it out. If I'd started putting all that detail in of all of the folds of the petal, then I'd be very unwilling to start moving it around and erasing it, but I can easily erase this. Once I'm happy with that, and let's say I am, because, okay, there are lots of interesting shapes around there, and it's reasonably nicely positioned within the rectangle. It's a good size for the rectangle. It's not too small, and it's not too large. Once we've done that, then you can start looking at that framework. We can start looking at the angle through the centre. If you remember the angle it was going up at in terms of the face of a clock. And some of the measurements across, for example, where that front sausage was going to go, how far back this should be, gauge how far that back should be, how far out my saucer should be at the back, or the petals which are going to be held within that saucer shape. I like to create that framework first. All of these drawing elements that I'm putting in, by the way, are purely a guideline for you. You can start putting in your ovals, your angles, as soon as you put this in. If you want to, you must find out what's right for you. What's right for one person is not right for the other. But I like to have a sort of framework first before I start to put on details like measurements of how wide these saucers and rims should be. Once I've got those in, then I can start to put in this sausage here. I can start to put in the shape of the trumpet, bearing in mind that the shape on both sides of this line are the same. Gives me a clue as to what these angles should be and what these shapes should be. And then the other larger, wider sausage at the bottom, like so. Even at this stage, if I felt that this whole thing was in the wrong place, it wouldn't be really hard to erase all this and move it across a quarter of an inch, a half an inch, because we haven't got into all of that detail. We haven't got involved in the detail, and therefore your drawing is easy to change. And that's really exactly what we need to know. You need to know that the drawing can change. If you feel you can make changes, you'll be a lot happier. You'll be a lot easier. Now I'm putting these leaves in where I want. I'm not copying the photograph. I'm getting my ideas from the photograph, but I'm thinking as I put these in about these interesting shapes around and about, and how the whole thing balances within the edges of the postcard. So I sit back now and I think, am I happy with that? If I am, it's then ready for the addition of all the detail that you require. Where you go from this point on is really up to you. But I don't like to get into minute detail straight away. I like to move down from these large shapes to slightly smaller ones. Break these shapes down a little bit. Let's start, first of all, with the trumpet head. And the first thing that I'd want to do is have a look at these edges, both these edges, because actually they're not straight, they're curves. But the line that we've got here already is going to give us a clue as to how that curve will work. And once we've got the curve on one side of this line correct, we feel that that's correct, the other curve on the other side can follow as a mirror image of the one above it, like so. When we come to the opening here of the trumpet, well, it's got lots of little corrugations here. But again, it's broken into certain shapes before it's broken into smaller pieces. Now, I'm making these lines quite strong. If you remember, these first lines should be very gentle. These should still be reasonably gentle, because we're going to go over it once again and put all of those little very small details in. So you don't want to end up with your drawing over heavy. So keep your lines as light as possible, as long as you see a progression as you build the lines up. Okay, now we've got these petals, these larger petals at the back, and they're going to fit generally within the saucer shape. And I say generally, because while that saucer shape is there to help you, you are never fixed completely by the drawing that's underneath. In other words, you should always feel you can change things. When I look at these shapes, let's look at the ones at the top to begin with, because these ones are definite petal shapes. They come out and they're sort of triangular. Two things I'd like to point out about this first triangle that I put on. The first thing is that it's gone a bit beyond my saucer, and that's fine. As I say, the saucer is just there to guide you. The reason it's gone beyond there is because I was looking at this shape against the shape on my photograph, and I felt that if I pulled that angle back, it would actually be wrong. So never feel that you can't change things. The drawing beneath is just there to help you, not to fix you in place. The other thing I'd say about that is this is a petal which in the photograph is going back in space. And that often confuses you when you look at it. Just think of this as a jigsaw piece. Imagine on your photograph that instead of drawing it, you're going to cut out that shape with a pair of scissors. And that's the shape that you're drawing. So you're not thinking about anything else, but it's basic shape on the surface of your drawing. So let's look at the next petal, which comes up around about here. And again, I think that goes a little bit beyond the saucer. This one here is a very strange one because it's coming out towards us. But again, don't worry about that. Think of it again as a piece of jigsaw that's going to fit in behind the trumpet, and how it's going to jut out towards the edge of the saucer. But look at that as a shape. Now, I know it's a series of curves. You'll notice that my natural tendency at this stage is to put things into straight lines. I find it easier to do that. It's just the way that I work. If you feel you want to go straight into curves, that's fine. It's whatever makes you feel more comfortable. So coming out in this petal is easier because it definitely has a petal shape as it goes out like so. And the one down below comes down here. Again, you can see generally I'm keeping to that saucer shape, but I'm not at all fixed by it. And there's another one just in the background like so. So that is the head of my daffodil. Now I want to move down into the stem and the leaves. The stem, if you remember, as it comes from the back of the flower, follows this line. So we can draw it around that line to begin with. And then it curves round and comes down at an angle. And it's quite fat. It's fatter, really, than one would imagine, I think, for a stem. Quite a strong stem there. And then the leaves. And as I say, I'm not copying the photograph exactly, but I can see that they are leaves which are slightly fatter at the top, and then they thin out as they go towards the ground. And as I put this one in, you see how I'm leaving this interesting bay between the leaf and the stem. So interesting spaces around and between. And as I put these in too, I'm not putting them in evenly, I'm giving uneven spaces between. That makes them a lot more natural. You'll also see that where I'm finishing them off, they're coming down at an angle. The base of them is coming down at an angle. So that again gives an interest to the general balance of the picture. So they're not all ending on a straight line along the bottom. So there we are. We've placed our flower, our stem, and our leaves, interestingly, on the postcard. We now want to go back and put in those details and those curves too that we haven't got in yet. But before I do that, I really do want to clean up the surface. I want to get rid of some of these structure lines that we used to make sure that the drawing was the right shape and it was going on in the right place. So for the first time, I'm actually going to use an eraser. I really believe that erasing lines is part of the drawing process because you're cleaning the surface and also you're making decisions as to which of these lines is correct. So, looking at the lines inside, that line that went through the middle, one of the framework lines, that should certainly come out, as should the saucer at the back of the flower head, so that we just leave the petals. But also, we should take out any lines which go in the wrong place. So I'm really cleaning up, as you can see, with the eraser. And I'm going to do that all the way through the drawing, until I really clean up, and all that's left is going to be those lines which are in the right place and are important enough to leave. And so I'm going to work through the drawing and clean it up, and then we're ready to put on the detail. Once the drawing has been cleaned up, we're ready now to add detail. But I don't want to put too much detail on yet, because we're going to add some colour to this drawing and turn it into a painting. So I'm going to concentrate really on the edges, on the silhouette of the image, so that the colours, when they go inside, will be nice and clean and pure. So let's start at the bottom here, and once more, I don't feel at all restricted by the lines I've already got down here. If I want to change my mind about where a line goes, I am feeling quite happy to do that. So I can move around here and put in some of these details down here. Now I'm moving quite quickly here in putting these details on. There's no rule at all which says how fast a drawing should be made. You must go along at your own pace, a pace that makes you feel happy and allows you to enjoy the drawing process. And the lines that you put down may not be exactly the same as mine, because everybody sees things differently and picks out different details. That's what makes us all so unique. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. That is perfect for a drawing, because it's going to make your drawing different to everyone else's. It's going to make your drawing unique. You may be following this tutorial, but you will be putting your own slant on what you see. And that's what's so special about drawing and painting, that everybody will see something different. But as you can see, I'm really concentrating on that outside edge. It doesn't mean that I'm not going to come back later on and put some of the detail inside. So don't feel, gosh, you're missing out some of those lines inside of the leaves. And certainly at this stage, I'm not putting on any shading at all, because the colour is going to do so much of that work for me. And so before I do any shading or any detail inside the flowers or the leaves or the stems, we're going to put colour on. And then we won't overburden the colour or the drawing as a whole, and it'll remain nice and fresh. So there's my drawing around the outside edge. I feel happy with the way the whole thing's balanced. I could go back on that if there's some areas that are a little bit dirty around the leaves and clean them up, but I think most of that now is going to be covered by the paint itself. There's a line here, for example, where I've gone inside that. I might just clean that up before I put the colour on, because that line might come through watercolour, which is very transparent. One won't see that line, to be honest. It doesn't matter that much. But what I'm saying is, if you want to clean the drawing up at this point with your eraser, this is the point to do it. But now we're going to move into colour itself.